Father, we thank you very much for this evening. Thank you for all your ministers you have used since the beginning of the Congress. Thank you for the mighty instruments you have used to speak your mind and your word to our hearts. We're praying, O Lord, that everything will make us to reach out and bring the lost back home. We pray, O Lord, that we will not neglect any part of your creation. The adult, the youth, the children, the men, the women, the educated, the illiterate, all people everywhere. We'll reach out to them. We'll show your love to them. We'll bring them back home. Help us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Tonight we are going to briefly consider the faithful minister and a fruitful ministry. You will see immediately that there is a connection between being faithful and being fruitful. The Lord wants us to be faithful. He has called us, and he expects we should be faithful unto him. On his own side, he is faithful. He is the faithful God. And Christ is called the faithful witness and the Amen. And we know that men of old, in Bible days, chosen by the Lord, were faithful to him. And the same grace that helped them to be faithful can help us to be faithful as well. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, reading from verses 1 and 2, let a man so account of us as of ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. He wants us to be faithful. In Colossians chapter 4, verse 17, and say unto Archippus, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received in the Lord, that thou fulfill it. Take heed to the ministry. You have received that ministry from the Lord. Please make sure that you fulfill that ministry. I'll be considering to start with fulfilling a divinely appointed ministry. Please understand, we're not just talking about fulfilling a ministry. We're talking about fulfilling a divinely appointed ministry. Every minister will have to find out that God has appointed him to fulfill a particular ministry. He has called you into the kingdom at such a time like this to do something in particular. It is not just that I will say I am busy, I am up and doing, I am zealous, I'm very active, I am doing something in the kingdom of God. The question is, have I been appointed for a particular thing? Am I staying on that thing I am appointed to do? Am I concentrating on that thing that God himself has planned for me to do? Am I intending to fulfill a divinely appointed ministry? As you find people in the New Testament and the Old Testament, you will discover that God appointed them to do some specific things in the kingdom at their time. And they made sure that they kept on looking at the thing the Lord wanted them to do so that they will concentrate. I don't need to tell you, I think you know this yourself already. There are 1,001 things, very good things you could do, and you may not be fulfilling the divinely appointed ministry. You need to find out what is the exact thing he wants us to get done as a minister of the gospel. And then concentrate on that, because that is what is going to check up on the last day. Let me just show you a few examples of people that were called in Bible days. And they were called to specific things. And they knew what they were called for. And those were the things they were to concentrate their lives on. In Exodus chapter 3, reading from verse 9 and verse 10. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me. And I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Say it in any way, describe it in any manner, write the details, the functions, the rules, whatever you think that Moses was to do. Here we have in verse 10 what he was appointed to do. And Moses was to keep this before him all the time. There were some people, the descendants of Abraham. The Lord loved them. And the Lord wanted to fulfill his covenant with Abraham. And he had seen them in captivity. And he had just one thing. There will be many aspects of that ministry. There will be many details of his function. There will be many areas of the activity. But when you sum it all up, when you analyze it, and when you focus on the real thing, the end result, bring them out, bring them through, bring them in. He was to bring out the children of Israel out of Egypt, through the wilderness, into the land of Canaan. Whatever else he did, whatever good things he might achieve, if that was not done, he wasn't fulfilling a divinely appointed ministry. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, and that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. You can see that it was a well-defined ministry. If we don't define very well what the Lord has called us to do, we'll be laboring in vain. We'll be beating about the bush. We'll be laboring and working and sweating, expending energy, resources, finance, everything. And yet, we may be living undone the exact thing he has appointed us to do. While I'm opening the Bible to Psalm 78, you need to be checking up on yourself. What is it the Lord has appointed you to do in the church? I need to make you understand about the call of God in Bible days. Have you noticed in the Old Testament, the Father called directly? At the beginning of the New Testament, it wasn't the Father calling directly anymore. Jesus called directly. But after the cross, in fact, after Pentecost, it wasn't Jesus calling directly. It was the Spirit calling directly. After the period of the Acts of the Apostles, it wasn't the Father calling directly. It wasn't Jesus calling directly. It wasn't the Holy Ghost calling directly. It was the minister, the leader, being used of God to appoint and to call. You find in the Old Testament, in the call of Moses, the Father called him directly. But you find in the case of Peter, in the case of John, in the case of Matthew, and in the case of Nathanael and Philip and those apostles, Jesus called them directly. You find in the Acts of the Apostles, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate unto me Barnabas and Saul for the work I have appointed them." But after the Acts of the Apostles, what do you find? Titus, "I have left thee in Crete that you may appoint other leaders as I appointed you." If you don't make all that distinction, you'll be waiting, you'll be saying, "God called Moses directly. I'm waiting for God to call me directly." No, that's not the dispensation now. Or you will be saying that Jesus Christ appeared at the shore, and by the riverside, he called Peter, "Follow me, I will make you fishers of men." And then you'll be saying, "I'm waiting for the voice of Jesus. When I hear the audible voice of Jesus, I will know the Lord is calling me." Or you might be waiting, saying, "I'm waiting for when the Holy Ghost himself
will convince me, will tell me, will appoint me and say, this is the work I have for you, then you might miss the call of God. Because now Paul the apostle said, Titus, I appointed you. Oh yes, the Father had hand in it, Jesus had hand in it, the Holy Ghost had hand in it. But now in the church age, he is using those leaders to call the people into the ministry. And today he calls us. It may be that it's your state overseer that God used, and then he puts you over the children work. It may be your region overseer that God has used, and he puts you in the student section. It may be the general superintendent that God has used to put you over that state or over that area. Understand, that is the method of the Lord today in appointing people into specific duties. In the case of Moses, there was something he was to do, and he knew it, and he knew that he had been appointed, bring out the people, bring them through the wilderness, bring them into the land of Canaan, and everything he was to do should revolve around that. When you have known the call of God upon your life, the divine appointment in your life, you will focus on that thing. You will not look this direction or look that direction. That singular thing, that peculiar thing, that appointed ministry the Lord has raised you up for, among the children perhaps, among the students perhaps, in the campus perhaps, among the women perhaps, or it is among the pastors perhaps, or it is in evangelism, or it is feeding the flock of God, or leading the people of God. You focus your attention on that thing. Recognize that ministry. Know that that is what you are called for. Stay with it. Stay by it. In Psalm 78. Psalm 78, reading from verse 70. Reading from verse 70 on to verse 72. Psalm 78, verse 70. He chose David, who was still in the old covenant, also a servant, and took him from the sheep, from the sheepfold, from following the youth great with young. He brought him to feed Jacob his people, to feed Israel his inheritance. So he fed them according to the integrity of his heart, and guided them by the skillfulness of his hands. You will see that God was very definite in the call of David. He said, what I'm calling you for, I want you to feed my people Jacob. That means the people of Israel, my inheritance. Saul had failed, but then he chose a man after his own heart to now do what Saul had failed to do. In the Old Testament, we had the people that were chosen by God to lead, to teach, to instruct the people of God. Malachi chapter 2. Malachi chapter 2, reading from verse 5. My covenant was with him of life and peace, and I gave them to him for fear, wherewith he feared me and was afraid before my name. The law of truth was in his mouth. Iniquity was not found in his lips. He walked with me in peace and equity, and did turn many away from iniquity. And this is talking about the priest. When God chose the priests, he gave them an assignment. Here was their divinely appointed ministry. The truth was to be in their mouth. Iniquity was not to be in their lives or in their lives. They were to walk in peace and equity and justice. They were to turn many away from their iniquity. When those priests were called, their assignment was clearly spelled out, and they were told that the end result of whatever it is they were doing was to turn many away from iniquity. In verse 7, for the priest's lips should keep knowledge, and they should seek the law at his mouth. For he is the messenger, the ambassador, the representative, the mouthpiece of the Lord of hosts. Therefore, the Lord appointed those priests. He said, I have a word for my people. I have a word for the children of Israel. If I were there physically myself, here is what I would have told them. But because God is spirit, He will not be there for them to see him, because no one can see him and live. Therefore he said, I have appointed you priests in Israel. You will hear the word from my mouth. You will give it unto the people, because the law of truth will be in your mouth, and that is what will be in your lips, that's knowledge. And the people will come and seek the law, because you are my messengers giving my message unto the people. Can you see very clearly as you look at the word of God, that when God appoints, he appoints us to a definite ministry. There is something to be done. We're not just beating about the bush. Therefore, if you are a worker, if you are a leader, if you are having any specific title in the church, ask yourself, what does this title carry? What responsibilities am I supposed to carry out as a result of the work I'm doing in the kingdom? In Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 15. Jeremiah 3:15, and I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. God was very definite. He appointed pastors, he appointed shepherds, he appointed overseers, he appointed leaders, and he said what they will do will be that they will feed the people with knowledge and understanding. If then we have been appointed by the Lord, and we are men and women after the mind of the Lord, after the heart of the Lord, here is what we're to do. We are to feed the people with the knowledge of the truth of the gospel. The New Testament makes it very clear in Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, reading from verse 28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers. These Acts of the Apostles now. It's not the Father calling them directly here. It's no more Jesus Christ by the shore of Galilee calling them directly now. The Holy Ghost has made you overseers in the Acts of the Apostles to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. He has purchased them. He has bought them, he has redeemed them, and we are called as overseers, as leaders, as pastors over them. We are to feed the church of the living God, feed them with knowledge of the word of God. In Acts chapter 9, Acts chapter 9, verse 15, the Lord said unto him, talking to Ananias concerning Paul, go thy way. For he, Paul, is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and the kings and the children of Israel. Here the Lord was saying that he had chosen Paul. He was a chosen vessel, a chosen minister, an appointed preacher, representative of God. And he was to bear the name of the Lord before the Gentiles. What does that mean? Everything the name stood for, by his name we're saved. There's no other name under heaven by which we're saved except the name of Jesus. Every authority, all the resources of heaven, all the riches of the kingdom of God, of the mysteries of the kingdom, they are already bound up, embedded in that name. And he was to bear that name and reveal that name and exalt that name and proclaim that name before the Gentiles and before the kings and before the children of Israel. The point here is the divinely appointed ministry was very clear, was very specific. In fact, he gives us the details in chapter 26. Acts chapter 26, reading from verse 16. But rise, stand up on thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness, both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee. Here Jesus Christ was talking directly to Paul the Apostle. He had met him, by the way, going to Damascus. and he had challenged him and he had confronted him. It's a hard thing for you to kick against the pricks. And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I'm Jesus whom you are persecuting. What shall I do now?" And part of the thing he revealed to him as he was giving his testimony later is that Jesus told him directly, "You will stand upon your feet. I have appeared unto you for this purpose, to make you a minister." It's the Lord that makes us. To make you a minister, he appoints, he makes us, he equips us, he develops us, he makes us capable to do what he wants us to do by his grace. A minister and a witness, both of the things you have seen and of those things in the which I will yet appear unto you. There is no time for me to develop, but I hope you understand that at that time the whole revelation had not been completed. We're talking about the time when the Lord appeared unto Paul. The epistle to the Romans had not been written. Corinthians had not been written. Galatians had not been written. Hebrews had not been written. All those epistles had not been written. You have known some things already. The old covenant is there. The gospels are there. I've already said some things. The things you have seen of my glory, of my encounter with you, and then of the things which I will still show you. Because it says when the Spirit is come, he will teach you all things. He'll bring to your remembrance the things I told you before, that thing that are past, and then he will teach you new things to now complete the whole revelation. But now we have the whole Bible. We have the Old Testament, we have the New Testament, and everything is now complete. And I cannot say, well, the Lord has now appointed me. There are some things in the Bible, I will teach that one. Then there are some other things not in the Bible, he will yet reveal that to me. No, we cannot do that now. Because the revelation is full and complete now. He has given us the full revelation now. Then in verse 17, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom I now send thee. He was sent to the Gentiles. He was sent to the people. What was he to do? The details of his ministry were clearly spelled out to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them that are sanctified by faith that is in me. That is, in the one talking to Paul. Not faith in Paul, but faith in Jesus who was talking to Paul the apostle. You will see very clearly then that there's a divinely appointed ministry. And what should be our concern when we talk about faithfulness is that we want to fulfill the divinely appointed ministry. Know what the Lord has appointed you for. Know the details of that ministry. And know exactly what the Lord is expecting from you. And then put everything you have into it so that you'll be able to fulfill the ministry. But if we're going to do that, it's going to require faithfulness. That leads me to point number two. Faithfulness in a spirit-directed ministry. He appoints, he directs. Faithfulness in a spirit-directed ministry. Do you know that there are people, they got saved, and the Spirit of God bore witness with their hearts, you are now children of God. They got sanctified, and the Spirit of God made them to know what were freely received from the Lord. They got baptized in the Holy Ghost, and the Spirit of God announced his presence and the fullness of coming in by the speaking in tongues. But that's the end. They not leave the Spirit of God behind, and they continue in ministry in their own strength. It must be Spirit-directed ministry. And you will know it's a spirit-directed ministry because he directs by the word. He directs us by the compassion in the heart. He creates a thirst in our heart, a passion within us, a compassion within us. Sometimes even an agony within us. Sometimes a desire within us. Sometimes he makes us to feel what the people are feeling. And he gives us the leaning, the tendency towards them. You know that the Lord is directing you. He wants you to reach out to these people. You have real concern for the youth. If you're a youth leader, you have a real real concern for the children. If you are a children worker, you have a real concern for members of the church, and it appears that your mind is there, your heart is there, you have real compassion on them, and the Spirit, through various ways, will be leading you and directing you to minister unto them. And you will be faithful as the Lord is directing you, as the Spirit of God is directing you as to what you are to do. Many times the Lord might wake you up and tell you, why don't you do it this way? Why don't you do it this way? Another time you are in a conference like this, and the Lord is telling you that in the past years we have not done enough. You could have done it this way and done it this way. Then you begin to write. You are setting goals. You are making plans. You are developing strategy, and the Lord begins to bring thoughts into your mind that you can expand that ministry this way, you can approach it this way, you can plan this program this way, you can plan the program that way. When the Spirit of God has directed that this is a way to reach more sinners, to save more souls, to develop the believers, to feed the church of God with the word of God, to mature the people, to train the workers, it is the Spirit of God directing you that this is what must be done. If you are going to be fruitful, you will need to be faithful to what the Lord is telling you to do. So that leads us to this point: faithfulness in a Spirit-directed ministry. We have examples in the Bible of the people that were faithful, and I believe that the same God that helped them to be faithful will help us to be faithful in Jesus' name. Hebrews chapter 3, and reading from verse 2. He who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was in all his house. Here we are told of two people. We're told of Jesus Christ, because if you read from verse 1, it's talking about Jesus Christ. You find that name at the end of verse 1. And then it says who, the antecedent is Jesus Christ. That is, the one that who is referring to is Jesus Christ. You can read it this way. The apostle and the high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ, who was faithful to him that appointed him. But then he brings in another man. He says, as also Moses was, he was faithful in all his house. His house here is referring to the children of Israel. I will dwell in them, I will move in them, I will walk in them. And the Lord counted Israel as the household of faith at that time. In fact, sometimes it's referred to as the house of Israel. Sometimes it's the house of David. Sometimes it's the house of God. And so with the children of Israel, in all the things that God wanted Moses to do, he was faithful in all his house. Of course, you know that the writing here has overlooked, has forgiven and forgotten. The thing that Moses did that was not right, the grace of God has covered that, and all that remains that God was thinking about was everything that he did right in leading the people to the point he led them before he was taken away from them. And so the testimony of Scripture is, since God has forgiven and forgotten the one that wasn't done right, Moses was now faithful in all his house. And then he refers to Jesus Christ, who never made any mistake, who never had any sin, who did everything exactly the way the Father wanted him to do it. And he said, who was faithful to him that appointed him. If you read the Gospel according to St. John, you'll find that many, many times the Lord Jesus Christ will say, I'm not alone, he that sent me is with me. It is my meat to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. He said, I say these things, not the way I want to say them, but I say them according to the word of him that sent me. Every time the Lord Jesus Christ will refer back to the Father, he wasn't independent in any way. He was faithful unto the one that appointed him. Let's look at John chapter 12 and verse 49 with verse 50. John chapter 12 verse 49. For I have not spoken of myself. Can you imagine that? He could have spoken of himself. Is the word personified? Is the word of God incarnate? And he could have spoken the word. He had knowledge, He had wisdom, a greater than Solomon is here. He said, a greater than all the Old Testament people, a greater than all those people is here. He said, before Abraham was, I am. He could have spoken by himself, but no. He wanted to show us faithfulness, that he did not speak anything of himself. But the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. That was the faithfulness of the Lord Jesus Christ. You have come to the Congress here this week. You have heard a lot of things. We have gone over the doctrines one by one again. We have gone through the series of spiritual warfare. We have gone through the series of sanctification. We have gone through the series of Second Timothy. We have gone through all the other messages as well. Now, he has given us what to do. Go back home in faithfulness, give the word of God as we have heard it, as we have learned it, as we have prayed about it, as we have shared it together here. Go and give it to the people at home. It will take that faithfulness before we can be fruitful. I mean, really fruitful in the sight of the Lord, in the presence of the Lord. In verse 50, and I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said unto me, so speak I. That is faithfulness as we're going back. And then we get back to our various locations, and we want to teach at the Bible study, and we want to lead in the revival meeting, and we want to lead in a Sunday fellowship, or we want to lead the children, or it is that we're leading the students, or it is that we're leading in the choir, or whatever it is we're doing. The pattern we have got here, the model we have got here, the standard we have got here, and the emphasis on the spiritual life we have got here, the emphasis on the holiness of life, on the grace of God, on doing everything according to the word of God, the emphasis we have seen here, faithfulness demands that when I go back to my location, I will not say, well, I've seen all that in the Bible. I've seen all those things that were emphasized, but this is my territory. This is my domain. This is my region. This is my state. I'm going to do it the way I feel. You may do it the way you feel on the last day. The Lord then might tell you, you are not faithful. You are not honest. You are not sincere. You did it your own way. You didn't do it God's own way. Do it God's own way, and the Lord will bless your ministry, and the Lord will bless you and bless the people you are ministering to in Jesus' name. In Matthew chapter 24, reading from verse 45. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord has made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season? The Lord Jesus Christ was speaking here. He was speaking of something spiritual. Who then is a faithful and wise servant? We're servants of the Lord. We're ministers of the Lord. We're stewards of the mysteries of the kingdom. We are answerable, responsible to the Lord. We are ambassadors of Christ. We are not alone. And the Lord walked with them because they preached the word with signs following. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. It is while you are doing that, I will be with you till the end of the age, the end of the world. We are servants of the Lord. We are not to please ourselves. We are to please him who has appointed us, whom the Lord has made, whom the Lord has made overseer, ruler, leader over his household. It is not my church. It is not your church. It is not our church. It is his church. He said his household. Therefore, we cannot say, this is my congregation. I will teach whatever I want. It's not your congregation. It's not mine either. Upon this rock, I will build my church. It is his church. And because it is his household, we cannot just feed them. We cannot say, well, I just like to talk about this. It's not what you like. whenever I am talking on this particular topic, it's like I'm riding on the wings of the air. No, it's not your emotion. It is not that you are riding on the wings. It's not that this makes you feel happy, makes you feel excited. When I'm on that topic, it's just my favorite. It's not your favorite one. Feed them with the balanced diet of the word of God. You are feeding the household of faith. There are sinners in the place, and the Lord wants you to preach salvation. There are people that need to make restitution. The Lord wants you to be faithful, that you will tell them the word of God, thus says the Lord. There are people that are discouraged. The Lord wants you to encourage them. There are people that are sick. He wants you to preach to them on how they can be healed. But it's not everybody that is sick. Therefore, you don't preach healing every Sunday, every Monday or Tuesday, every Thursday or Friday. Every time you are talking about healing, talking about healing, talking about healing, what will happen? If our country here, if we change the industry, change it to hospital. If we change secondary school, change it to hospital. If we change primary school, change it to hospital. If we change the tailor's shop, change it to hospital. If we change the polytechnics, change it to hospital. If we change university, change everything to hospital. Medicine is very important. And the healing is very important. People getting well is very important. And we change everything into hospital. There will be no school left. There will be nobody to sew our clothes. There will be nobody to teach anyone at all. Because everything is now healing, 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 healing. We need the hospitals. Let them stay. We need the schools. Let them stay. We need the factories. Let them say, that's like a church. In the church, you have many, many needs in the church. And it is not only healing that the people need. It's not only deliverance that the people need. They need holiness too. They need sanctification too. Because that's what will prepare them for heaven. We need to be balanced as children of God, as ministers of the gospel. Then it says in verse 46, blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. He has given us the responsibility. And then when he comes, he finds us doing it just like that. In Titus chapter 1, reading from verse 9. Titus 1, verse 9. Holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught. Holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught. You have been taught. And I say, where you have been taught? You have been taught through a particular method, a particular system, in a systematic way. And the way you are to hold the word faithfully is the way you have been taught. The way you got it is the way you pass it on to other people. Please allow me to make an illustration. When I was at school, I had teachers that taught me. And they taught me my subject that I did at that time. And I was a particular teacher, and I still remember him till this present day. And he taught in a very systematic way. And in fact, even if you didn't write notes in our class, even if you didn't do anything, you didn't go to the library to read too much, and you didn't go about searching for this and searching for that, that teacher, he will teach very clearly and you will understand. And I still remember, even though it's now more than 25, 26 years ago that he did that, he'll come to the class, he would have taught us something the previous day. He'll come to the class and for the first 10 minutes he'll say, yesterday we learned, and then he'll go through everything and review. And then from now, from that one, he'll go to the new topic he was doing. He was going to do them. If anybody, any of us, raised up our hands and will say, excuse me, please, he'll say, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute, always, every day. And so eventually when he finishes, you can then ask questions and everybody will understand. And if you didn't understand, it's going to come to you privately and it's going to work everything out. We loved him. And when I started teaching my subject in the secondary school, when I was still teaching, I used exactly the same method. I will teach them, I come back to the class and then review what I've done and then go from there to the next point. And if anybody was asking question and I didn't want him to, I'll say, wait a minute. Now, my professor who taught me at that time, he wasn't in the classroom with me, but I learned and I understood the word very, I understood the subject very clearly the way he taught. And I felt if I wanted my students to understand, he taught me and I understood, I could use the same method and the people would understand. And when I became a preacher, it was the same thing. In fact, I transferred a lot of what his method and what he did into the spiritual aspect. And I started teaching as well. The same thing you have been taught, you have been taught very clearly. We didn't confuse you. Everything was very clear to you. Everything was systematic. You go back to your location now and you will teach in the same systematic way that you have learned. That is the faithfulness the Lord requires from you and from me. We will do it in Jesus' name. And as we do it, the work of the Lord will prosper in our hands in Jesus' name. There is a challenging example I find in the Old Testament. It's the example of Joshua. Look at Joshua chapter 11 and verse 15. Joshua chapter 11 verse 15. As the Lord commanded Moses, his servant, so did Moses commanded Joshua. And so did Joshua. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord commanded Moses. That's faithfulness. Moses had died. Moses was no more physically present there. But Joshua continued. The same thing that Moses had handed over to him, he handed over to the people. And if you read the account of Joshua, you will find that the work prospered in his hand. In Joshua chapter 24, look at this beautiful verse of scripture. Joshua chapter 24 and verse 31. And Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua. What else do you want? That's fruit. That's result. That's the harvest. That's what we're looking for. That's the testimony we want the Lord and the Spirit of the Lord to bear on our behalf. That's the testimony we want God to write in his book of records concerning us. That's the testimony that has been written down in the book of records, in the book of God, in the Bible concerning Joshua. That Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua. All the days of the elders that outlived Joshua. Do you know what Joshua did? As Moses passed to him, he too passed on to the elders that were walking with him, but they were younger than he was. And when he had left and they outlived him, that is, they were still alive after Joshua had died. We are told that the children of Israel, they didn't go back to idolatry. They kept on serving the Lord in the days of all the elders that outlived Joshua, which had known all the works of the Lord and that he had done for Israel. I believe you will have that same result. That means you will bear fruit. If we are going to bear fruit, we must be faithful. One, be faithful to the Lord who has appointed you. Two, be faithful to the word of God. Don't add to it. Don't subtract from it. We are guilty, as much guilty when we add to the word as when we subtract from the word. Don't add your own peculiarities unto the word. Leave the word as it is. The word is sufficient. Let us be faithful to the word of God. If the word of God condemns me, convicts me, corrects me, I must not say, no, I'm a pastor. The word of God cannot correct me. I'm above the word of God now. No, there is nobody above the word of God. If the word of God corrects me as the general superintendent of the church, I must take correction. If the word of God corrects you as a state overseer, region overseer, as a local pastor, you must take correction. So that you'll be faithful to the word. Not only that, you are faithful to the church. You see, you are serving in the church. We're looking up to you as members of the church, and your life will affect us. If your life contradicts the message you are giving us in the church, it's going to discourage us. It's going to make us feel that nobody can do this thing. Nobody can obey the word of God, because our leader who is teaching us, he himself cannot obey. Therefore, be faithful to the church and make sure that everything you do in faithfulness to what we have learned. Be faithful to your calling. The Lord has called you, and the Lord has appointed you, and you have consecrated yourself on the altar that you will serve the Lord. Remain faithful. Be faithful to the promises you have made to the Lord. You know how many promises you have made to the Lord this week? And you know, sometimes we have cried, sometimes we have wept, sometimes we have shouted, sometimes we couldn't even shout or cry, but the tears were just coming down, and in the depth of our being, we are telling the Lord, oh Lord, thank you for your mercy, thank you for your grace, thank you for overlooking all those things. This is a new year, a new thing is going to begin. I'm going to give my whole self into it now. Be faithful to the promises you are making unto the Lord. Be faithful to the Spirit of God. He'll be telling you in your church, in your location, is this right? Should things be like this? Do you think this will mature the people? Do you think that this will really encourage the people to be holy? Do you think that if you continue like this, it will make the people to be prepared for the rapture? Be faithful to those promptings of the Spirit of God and say, Lord, I'm going to do everything the way you want it done. And then we're going to bear fruit. That leads me to point number three, fruitfulness in a God-honoring ministry. If we are going to be fruitful, the ministry will be honoring God. It will be pleasing God. A God-honoring ministry, a God-pleasing ministry. Everything you are doing in the ministry, your goal, your mind is, how does this exalt the Lord? Honor the Lord. Glorify the Lord. He exalts his word above his name. If it is going to honor the Lord, it will be truthful and faithful to the word of God. Therefore, how is this honoring the Lord, pleasing to the Lord, exalting the Lord, glorifying the Lord, leading people unto the Lord? Let it be a God-honoring ministry, a God-pleasing ministry, and then the Lord himself will make you to bear fruit. In John chapter 15, John chapter 15, reading from verse 8 and verse 16. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. It honors the Lord when we bear fruit. That means you have converts. It honors the Lord when converts are discipled as part of fruit. It honors the Lord when they are unstable in your fellowship, when they become steadfast and stable is part of the fruit of ministry. It honors the Lord when the immature people in the fellowship, when they become matured, it honors the Lord, is part of the fruit. It honors the Lord when people who are coming for the first time to the church, they hear the word of God, they are convicted, and they say, I never attended a service like that before. It revealed me and made me naked before the eyes of the Almighty God. What can I do to be saved? That ministry is honoring the Lord. It honors the Lord when people who are discouraged and people who are downtrodden, when they come and they are lifted up and their faith is built up and they are able to pray, they are able to hold on to the promises of God. That's the fruit we're talking about. It honors the Lord when somebody who is fed up with life, he wanted to commit suicide, but I just heard they were singing in that assembly, before I go to take my life, let me see what they are doing over there. The fellow comes in, he hears of the love of God, of the grace of God, he hears of hope in Christ, and he says, I didn't know all this was available before. Why will I destroy myself? And he gives himself to the Lord, and a new life begins for that person. That's a ministry that honors the Lord and is bearing fruit. It honors the Lord when young people are calling themselves, they're excited about coming to church. Young people are not saying, we don't like to come to church because the church is dull.
because the church has nothing to offer, because the church is too harsh, because the church does not even think that we are there. They don't give any example that we are there in their sermons or anything. We are just there. They are not excited about the service. That does not honor the Lord. That's not bearing fruit. It honors the Lord when children go to their neighborhoods on Saturday and they are saying, Sunday is tomorrow. It's the best day of the week. We're going to get to church and it's going to be a wonderful experience getting to church, and I cannot miss Sunday service in our church, therefore come along. And they are calling other children, other young people. That honors the Lord. That's bearing fruit. It honors the Lord when some people in the community, they are downtrodden and they are downcast and they are and somebody looks at them and he says, well, I'm not saying you should leave your church, but in this your condition you need a kind of spiritual tonic. And I know you can get that tonic if you follow me to our church tomorrow. And I'm telling you that you can. What a trial will convince you. Just come along with me. And the fellow comes to church. And truly enough, the choir begins to sing. And then the sorrow is melting away. And everything is melting away. And the fellow felt, this is wonderful. The Lord is here indeed. And I did not know it. That honors the Lord. That is the fruit we're talking about. When somebody comes to the church and he says, I didn't know that something like this available. I will never go to another place anymore. You don't even need to come and invite me anymore. This is now my home church because of the kind of effect and the influence and the impact he sees in that church. That's what we're to go back and do. And ask yourself, in our church, in our local church, are people coming like that? Are they excited to come? Are they happy that they are coming? Is God doing something for them? Are their lives being transformed? Are their lives being changed? Is the grace of God entering into their lives? Is the Lord being honored, being glorified, being exalted? And the people that are coming, are they getting something of heaven in their soul while they are still on earth here? Let us go back and bear fruit. This is what will glorify the Lord and honor the Lord, that you bear fruit. In that same chapter of John, chapter 15, and in verse 16, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit. That's why you have been appointed. That's why you have been chosen, that you will go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain. That your fruit should remain. Now, if you have a church of 300 people, and in a church of 300 people, as 10 people are getting converted and coming into the church, by the back door, 10 of the people who were there before are backsliding and going out of the back door. So you still remain 300, because you have 300 plus 10 minus 10 at the back door. So you are laboring, they come in, and others are going out. That's not bearing fruit. The fruit is not remaining. The fruit is not abiding. This year, our fruit will remain. Our fruit will abide. And you know, it's going to reward you on the final day by your faithfulness and fruitfulness. What if the Lord should say, you've done enough, stop. And then he says, I'm going to reward you now. Remember, whatever reward you get, you are going to carry throughout eternity. If you get something insignificant, not tangible, something that you'll say, see what I've got, can I call this a reward? That's what you are going to keep for 1,000 years, for 1,000,000 years, for 10 million years, for all eternity. Why don't you spend your life for the Lord? In this single life you have, that when you get home, when you get to heaven, all heaven will stand at attention. They will say, brother so-and-so is coming, sister so-and-so is coming. And then Jesus will be standing. He'll be welcoming you, saying, well done, good and faithful servants. Enter into the kingdom and the joy of your Lord. He says, look at your mansion. All the time you are walking on earth, I was walking in heaven preparing this for you. We all appreciate you. We know that you spent everything, the very last blood in your system, just for the preaching of the gospel. And then you have a great, great, great reward that even angels, in a positive way, in a clean sense, might even be envious of you. It can be done. We can do it. But Your life is still there. By the grace of God, you are still young. And the Lord is going to preserve your life. He'll keep you healthy. He'll give you all the grace you need, all the gift you need. If you have been faithful in the past, you can tell the Lord, I'm going to start afresh. Please, Lord, forgive the past. Forget the past. Give me another chance. Begin a new chapter in my life. Write something new. I want to serve you. I want to be faithful. I want to be fruitful. Let's rise up and pray and talk to the Lord, that the Lord himself will make you fruitful. The Lord will make you faithful, and the Lord will make you fruitful. Don't allow tiredness of the body to stop you from praying. Tell the Lord your mind. Tell him your heart. You can start afresh. Have you not seen areas of unfaithfulness in your life and in your ministry? Are you preaching the word? Are you getting sinners soundly converted, born again, having a change of life? Are you maturing believers? Are you training workers? Are you making the gospel interesting to the young people? Are you bringing children from the wilderness of sin into the household of faith? Women, are you leading those other women to love the Lord, to serve the Lord, to give themselves completely and fully to the Lord? Members of the choir, are we giving our best to sing and melt the hardness in the hearts of people? To sing and prepare their hearts, to make their hearts a fruitful, good soil that will receive the word of God. Do it, and the Lord will bless you. Be faithful. The Lord will give you the fruit if you can only be faithful. On that final day, the Lord will reward you abundantly.